فستبشر ويبشرون بأيكم المفتون إن ربك هو أعلم بمن ضل عن سبيله وهو أعلم بالمهتدين فلا تطع المكذبين صدق الله العلي العظيم. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shadaqallahul azim, shadaqallahul azim, shadaqallahul azim. Maha benar Allah dengan segala firman-Nya. Before that, for your information, please rename your profile name on the screen based on mahasiswa underscore fakultas. I mean, mahasiswa name, your name, and underscore your faculty name. Once again, I'd like to give information that to all the students who are attending this lecture, please rename your name tag or your profile name on the screen based on mahasiswa name underscore faculty name.
And also department name, Miss.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and you can add the department name. Okay, we'll continue to the next agenda is singing National Anthem Indonesia Raya and Sang Surya. Pak Muhammad Taufik, boleh dibantu. Well, okay, thank you, Pak Taufik Muhammad. Now, the excellencies, all lecturers, students, and distinguished guests, step onto the following agenda is speech. For the opening speech, here are from the Dean of Engineering Faculty, Dr. Insinyur Waspada Kurniadi, Master of Science. Is there Dr. Waspada already joined? Hello, Dr. Waspada. We can wait for a moment. One thing that maybe you should check the chat box to fill out the attendance list. That's different from every faculty or maybe every department. Okay, we give you time to fill out the attendance list for a moment. And once again, I welcome you to all the lecturers from every department in Universitas Muhammadiyah Tasikmalaya. And now we are waiting for the Dean of Engineering Faculty to give the opening speech. We apologize that our rector cannot attend this meeting because suddenly they have an emergency meeting in another place. Okay, for your information here, also I remind you that maybe your other friends haven't joined this meeting, so I hope that you can ask them to join our lecture today. Well, okay. While waiting, I'd like to give you some another information also about International Office UMTAS, Universitas Muhammadiyah Tasikmalaya. So this is one of the units in UMTAS, provide the international relationship. And we have several programs that we plan to do for next year. According to the student exchange and also for joint supervisor. So it means that I hope all of you students prepare your English skill and also maybe by your TOEFL, because we need to do selection for all students who are eligible to do the student exchange to Malaysia. So our plan and our program for next year is we will hold the student exchange outbound. Outbound means we send the student here from Indonesia, from UMTAS to Malaysia. Why we choose Malaysia? Because Malaysia is near to Indonesia and our language also have a quite similar accent, not accent, maybe just because we may understand about what they say. So from now on, I hope that you can start to increase your skill in English communication and also maybe for TOEFL or maybe writing, speaking, writing, and also for reading, because we may have program for about 3 until 6 months. We send you there. You will study. So we hope that you can have experience to join and also to learn about the culture in Malaysia. After that country, maybe program, and we plan to another country or another ocean.
Yeah, maybe Taiwan the next.
No, I think Europa.
Oh, Europe. Okay.
I think for a country that have native in English, yeah, because if Taiwan, you will have difficulties in Mandarin. But if you have the ability in Mandarin language, maybe it's will be so good for you. So Dr. Waspada is already here yet or not yet?
Not yet.
The lecture from the guest lecturer, from Professor Mukhtar, he will be joined on 1:30 p.m. So before that, we will do our session first. Oh, another program that I remember that like joint supervisor. Joint supervisor here means that when you do the thesis, bachelor thesis, undergraduate thesis, or under the undergraduate, I don't know what's the name for the Indonesian scripsi. Like scripsi,
yeah.
You will have three supervisors. Supervisor means pembimbing. You have three pembimbing, two from UMTAS and another one is from outside country. And what is the outcome that you will give to be the output? It's like you have to do the publication, like international publication.
For all department, Miss, or selected department?
Yeah, we provide for all department.
Mm.
All department, actually. Oh, Dr. Waspada will be joined about 50 minutes later. And once again, I will inform you that thank you for the attending for all of the lecturers in all department and also for students, especially from Diploma of Nursing Department, Bachelor of Nursing Department, Profession of Nursing Department, Midwifery Department, which is those are from the Faculty of Health Sciences in UMTAS. And also another faculty is Engineering Faculty. They are Mechanical Engineering Department, Electrical Engineering Department, Environmental Engineering Department, and Mining Engineering Department. And the last is from the Education and Teacher Training Faculty. Here, the last and the least Information Technology Education Department. Thank you for coming and just wait a moment, okay? Oke, okay, so Dr. Waspada, you are ready.
Assalamualaikum.
Ya, waalaikumsalam, Pak.
Waalaikumsalam.
Welcome, selamat datang, Pak. We are glad to have you here. And now is the session that we hope you give us the opening speech. So time is yours.
Start, it's me, for me already?
Yeah, directly for you, sir.
All right. Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Witt.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
The faculty member, distinguished guests, my colleague, and students. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah alladzi arsala rasulahu bilhuda wa dinil haq liyudhirahu ala dini kulihi wa kafa billahi syahidah. Ashadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la syarikalah wa ashadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasul. Allahumma salli ala muhammad wa ala alihi wala asabihi asma'in amma ba'du. It's my great pleasure to welcome all of you to the webinar on technology in industrial revolutions 4.0. I am Waspada Kurniadi, Dean of Engineering Faculty, University of Muhammadiyah Tasikmalaya. As it is the first international seminar hosted by Engineering Faculty, Universitas Muhammadiyah Tasikmalaya during pandemic COVID-19. I would like to extend warm welcome to our distinguished guest lecturer, Professor Dr. Mohairi Makhtar from University of Sultan Zainal Abidin, UNIZA, Malaysia. It is honorable for us to have his lecture on Industry 4.0, its applications in medical field. The topic is closely related to the current global issues currently on pandemic COVID-19, which drain our effort and resources to cover with. The pandemic is not over yet, and there are still many challenges to our professional capability on technology and engineering and contributions on healing the world. I believe the topic of the lecture today is inspiring and giving us new horizon on Industry 4.0. I would extend my special thanks for Professor Mohairi Makhtar for sharing his knowledge with the hope of having further close cooperations between UNIZA and UMTAS. May Allah bless us and all of our activities. On behalf of Rector of UMTAS, which is unintentionally he has to attend at the meeting, he asked me to open this seminar. So this seminar, I mean it open. Thank you very much. Nasrun minallahi wa fatun qarib. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you so much, Dr. Waspada, for the opening speech. And as we finish our opening to lead the next session, I'd like to introduce our moderator here, Mr. Miftahul Falah, MSN. So I'd like to share the CV of Miftahul Falah, MSN. Because Mr. Miftahul Falah here already graduated from NGNHS Taiwan 3 years ago from nursing department and gained degree in Master Science of Nursing. Now he is working in UMTAS for nursing department, bachelor degree in Faculty of Health Sciences. Here is the CV. The full name is Miftahul Falah Eskap, NSMSN, born on Bengkulu, 17th April 1992, religion Islam, address Kampung Cibatur Wetan, RT 01 RW 12, Kecamatan Mangkubumi, Kota Tasikmalaya. Profession, lecturer in nursing department, Faculty of Health Sciences, Universitas Muhammadiyah Tasikmalaya. Contact number and the email already stated on the screen. Maybe you can note that. Also for education background, bachelor degree here from Universitas Muhammadiyah Tasikmalaya. Nurse profession, Universitas Muhammadiyah Tasikmalaya. For master program, already graduated from National Taipei University of Nursing and Health Sciences or NTUNHS Taiwan since already 2018. And for the ongoing activity now is still studying in Lincoln University College, Malaysia. So here we welcome our moderator, Mr. Miftahul Falah, Master Science in Nursing. You can open the mic and open the video. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much for the time, Ms. Fitri. Okay. this is an honor for me because this is kind of the guest lecture for the next session. So we, for the UNTAS, we already have a first session for from the USM, maybe a couple months ago. And then now we are going for the next lecture, guest lecture. So now we also invite the keynote speaker from the same country, which is Malaysia, but we have a different university. So now we have from the University Saint Zainal Abidin, Unisia, Malaysia. All right, so by the way, the Prof. Mohairi is already here. Let me see. Okay. All right. But we already informed them that he will join with us maybe around 1:30, right? Okay, so we just wait for him, and then after he's joined, so we can start for this international webinar guest lecture. So, okay. Ah, okay. Assalamualaikum, Prof. You already here? Okay, I can see. Oh, sorry. Okay, admin, please mute for the Professor Mohairi. Okay, you can test for the second, Prof.
Yeah.
Okay. Assalamualaikum, Prof.
Waalaikumsalam.
Alhamdulillah. Okay, thank you very much for coming in our webinar international. Okay, can we start, Prof?
Yeah. I'll share slide.
All right. But before that, I will introduce your guests, okay? All right. Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you for warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
All right. Thank you for joining us for today's guest lecture virtual seminar. My name is Miftah Hupalah, and I will be responsible for moderating today's activity. In this occasion, we will have a best speaker from University Sultan Zainal Abidin, which is Unisia, Malaysia. And I'm glad to welcome of our excellent speaker who will say us about Industry 4.0 application in medical field. So we know that we are all absolutely agree that today's guest lecture topics is very important for us as a lecturer, student, and healthcare profession to create a great future in the international scope. But before we get started, I have a few notes for the audience, please. Okay, today's virtual seminar is being recorded to be available for viewing post-seminar, and a speaker today will have a total of 45 to 50 minutes to deliver the presentation, and then following by 10 to 15 minutes for the question and answer. And then if you have any question for the speaker, please type your question to the chat box of your Zoom. I will choose to select the question and read them for the speaker to answer after the presentation ended. And lastly, if you have any technical question, please reach me out directly via the chat function, and our technical team will be assisting you directly. All right, to begin this keynote speaker speech section, let's invite our best speaker, Professor Dr. Mohairi Mukhtar. Assalamualaikum, Prof.
Waalaikumsalam.
How are you?
Fine, thank you. How are you?
All right, okay. My voice is clear, Prof?
Yeah, very clear.
All right, okay, thank you. Okay, you look so powerful today, Prof. Alhamdulillah. Okay. All right.
Had your lunch today?
Yes. Yes, we have ready. Okay. All right, before we start listening to Prof. Muhairi's presentation, I will briefly introduce him to all of you. All right, okay, let me share his PPT, CV first. All right. Okay. We know that he is one of the famous people in Malaysia, so we can see here. So we can see he is on the TV already. Okay. His name is Professor Dr. Muhairi Mukhtar from the faculty is Faculty Informatics and Computing, and department is from the Computer Science, and his specialization is Ansible Method for Mechanism Learning and Data Mining and Big Data Analytics, Software Development and Timetabling and Blockchain. All right, he is Malaysian, so we know that he's originally coming from the Malaysian. All right, okay. So, Professor, you can speak Malay, right?
Yeah.
All right. Okay, okay. We can do a mix.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, okay. Because some our audience is coming from the Bahasa, so we use the Bahasa all the day, so
okay, no
maybe
problem.
You can mix it. Okay.
Yeah, sure.
All right. And then for the academic qualification, he's graduated from the diploma. He's come in 1997 from College Agama Sultan Zainal Abidin, Kusja, and then in 2000, he's graduated from Bachelor of Nursing Technology, University of Malaysia, UM, and then for the Master of Information Technology, is already graduated in 2003 from the University Kebangsaan Malaysia, UKM, and for the Doctor of Philosophy, or PhD, in 2012, is already graduating from the University of Brentford, United Kingdom. Wow, nice. Okay. And then he's already graduated for got some scholarship. He's already here, so I cannot mention one by one. So you can read after we finish this section. Okay, and this for the employment history. Okay, so the professor, and then for this is the for the research activities. Yes, but I cannot mention one by one because it's too much for us. Okay, and then it is for the copyrights granted. It's already there. And then for the award academics, so it's already got from the Innovation Awards, Bachelor Group Awards, and then Research Book Awards, and the Professional Technologies Award, and Graduate Technology Award. So he's really expert from this technology. All right. Okay, that just for the brief information for you. And then for more information about his biography and presentation file, please go to our faculty website and you can download it as you desire, okay? As a simple reminder, please type your question you would like to ask to the speaker in the chat box of your Zoom application, and I will read them after the presentation is over. All right. I will now turn the time and the screen over to Prof. Muhairi to begin presentation about the Industry 4.0 applications in medical field. You will have 45 to 50 minutes, Professor, to deliver your presentation. Okay, time is yours.
Right. Or maybe shorter than that. Is it fine?
All right, it's okay.
Okay.
We can flexible.
Okay, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you to our MC today, pengacara majlis, Miftah, alright?
Yes, yes, Rob.
Okay, and good afternoon to all. Salam tengah hari. Thank you also to the organizer, congratulation untuk menganjurkan majlis kita pada petang ini. Tuan-tuan, puan-puan, ladies and gentlemen, I'm Muhairi from University Sultan Zainal Abidin, UNIZA. So thank you for the brief introduction of myself by MC just now. So for today, I would like to talk about Industry 4.0 technology and the application in medical field. in healthcare. All right. So for the agenda, so let me share the slide. Okay, so for the today's agenda, so I'll start with introduction, basic, what is Industry 1.0? And then up to 4.0, the transition characteristic and historical related to healthcare, right? From the point of view 1.0 to 4.0. And then I'll cover technologies and application related to medical field, okay? And then last part, I'll share our experience in UNIZA. Related to one of the application for COVID-19 screening. It's already almost 2 years, the application that we use here in UNIZA. Okay, if we, now we are in 4.0 right now, okay. So the interest is growing very high. In healthcare delivery in the context of rapid development in medical device, okay, clinical advancement, data analytic, and also information technology. In when we talk about digital health technology, such as electronic health record, health monitoring, and also the devices, okay, wearable devices. And but the most important is all those things, it has a major impact to our socio-economic and society, right? So this technology led to generate numerous innovation opportunities as well as substantial challenge for care delivery and also offering a chance to move beyond a traditional scope of healthcare engineering to the right now 4.0 healthcare. To improve, the main aim is to achieve and improve the patient experience, population health, and by using technology, we also can control costs. Okay, and another important is clinician satisfaction. Okay, so those paradigm. Okay, so we shift the paradigm and we refer that. As healthcare 4.0, okay, so which is it include wired and wireless equipment, sensors and devices that install not just in hospital but also in clinic, home, pharmacies and many other care environments that have a connection. So right now, Wi-Fi is most important in our life today. So from before we move from what is related to medical or healthcare, I think better we go back and get understanding related to industrial 1.0 to 4.0. Okay, so because of the emerging this technology from 1.0 to 4.0, it's not just medical healthcare, it also memberi kesan, give impact to other field. Business, manufacturing, education. We also have EDU 1.0, EDU 2.0, up to EDU 4.0. That's semua itu disebabkan because of the perkembangan teknologi from 1.0 to 4.0. Kalau kita tengok start from 1.0, okay, sebenarnya that time, okay, kita adalah banyaknya adalah agriculture, okay? And then apa yang berlaku, kita move to industrialization. That's 1.0. How many years ago? Apa ni? Abad ke 18, okay? Sehingga pertengahan late 19th century. So the technology yang ada pada masa itu lebih kepada steam engine, sewing machine, okay, build road. So that's a kind of technology yang ada at that time. And then we move from 1.0 to 2.0. So that time kita dah start ada electricity. Hello.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Terputus. Yes, terputus suddenly.
Hello.
Okay.
Terputus line.
Yeah. But it's okay now.
I can hear you.
Okay. Prop. You can hear me?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So, saya ada connection problem maybe.
All
okay,
right.
I continue. So kita pergi kepada 3.0. So dah start ada robotik, automation, computers. So lebih kurang 20th century. Okay, pada masa ni kita dah start ada development of electronic computer, robotik. So yang mana this technology led to system, okay, computerized system. So banyak yang berlaku. Selepas 3.0 kita pun dah ada internet.
Yeah.
So dah kita move kepada computerization system, okay. So robotik pun dah ada, dah start ada, automation pun dah berlaku, disebabkan perkembangan komputer pada masa tersebut. And now kita berada pada 4.0, okay. So dia lebih kepada integration between cyber physical system, so kita ada cyber and then kita ada physical. So how to we want to integrate those menggunakan apa ni? Dia ada pillars, dia ada setengah tu, dia ada 9 pillars, ada 8 pillars. Teknologi yang penting lah. Contoh IoT, big data, AI, okay, cloud computing, AR, VR. Okay. So sekarang ni dengan current teknologi yang ada, how kita nak apply ke dalam certain domain ataupun field lah. So dalam case yang kita discuss hari ni, dalam bidang medical, healthcare, right? So mungkin dalam bidang education pun nak ada. So dengan teknologi yang sama, macam mana kita nak implement dalam education. Okay. So kalau kita tengok karakteristik 1.0, sebenarnya daripada dia move from simple kepada complex, right? In term of dia punya data, facility, teknologi, right? So daripada 1.0 dengan 2.0 tadi, up to 4.0. So bagaimana kita boleh relate dengan healthcare evolution dalam medical. So kita pun ada healthcare 1.0 up to 4.0. So because of pada masa pada awal tu, dalam konteks industri dia ada apa tadi? Ada steam engine dan sebagainya. So in healthcare, dia adalah sebenarnya proses dia itulah straightforward punya proses. Kalau kita sakit, kita straight find doctors and then doctor prescribe dan bagi ubat, okay. So straightforward, and then kita pergi pada 2.0. So dekat sini bila dah ada 2.0 industri tadi, dia dah start building machine, dah ada mass production machine. So dekat sini healthcare punya industri pun dia dah start develop devices, device untuk monitoring. So dah start ada medical equipment lah yang boleh digunakan untuk dalam bidang healthcare. So untuk healthcare 3.0, so just now industri 3.0 we have a computerized system. So dia berlaku pada sama dalam medical healthcare. So pada masa ini dah start ada information system. Semua rekod dah digital. Kita boleh simpan dalam server at that time. Okay. Dan bila dah start ada internet dan sebagainya, dia dah jadi start online. Okay. So that's berlaku pada healthcare 3.0. Okay. So untuk 4.0, because of kita ada IoT, ada AR, VR, big data dan sebagainya. So kesemua teknologi tersebut dia membantu memberi kelebihan and advance lah kepada healthcare, yang mana kesemuanya tu biasa kalau kita dengar smart, intelligent, smart healthcare, intelligent healthcare. So that's relate tu kepada sekarang punya evolution lah 4.0. Dan IoT tu kita dah start ada sensor, kita boleh connect automatic sensors dengan hospital ke, dengan ambulans dan sebagainya. Okay. So yang penting ada dua major elements dalam healthcare ni. Yang pertama smartness and also prediction analysis. So actually semua yang teknologi 4.0 tadi dia smart lah eh. Dia smart. Oh, connection saya tak berapa nak stable. Dan juga bila kita ada prediction analysis, that kita boleh analyze lah data-data kita untuk forecast something in the future, right? Menggunakan data-data yang kita ada. So bila sensors dah banyak, so sensors so akan collect data every second, okay? Dan nowadays kita pun kita ada phone, smartphone, so banyak data kita produce melalui kita punya smartphone, media sosial dan sebagainya. So that lead to big data. So data-data yang ada ni sangat berharga untuk kita analyse. So at the end data ni boleh membantu untuk membuat decision dengan lebih baik. So function industri, so apa yang kita boleh buat dengan adanya teknologi tadi tu, of course benefit dia boleh maximize productivity. So kita boleh increase accuracy, machine pun dah power, so kita boleh connect dengan device, so dia boleh reduce mungkin masa dengan cost, of course quality, paperwork kita akan reduce because everything is digital. Okay, kemudian kita boleh ada beberapa innovation lah yang sesuai untuk membantu doctors dan juga hospital menggunakan sensor system. Okay, so kita punya sistem pun daripada 3.0 dia lebih kepada store data. Okay, so kita input and kita store. So now the information system become dia punya level adalah lebih kepada executive punya decision lah, untuk fokus untuk analisis yang boleh buat prediction. Okay, so menggunakan data-data yang ada. Okay, kalau ini industri 4.0 punya teknologi, kita ada AR, system integration, cloud computing, big data, IoT, 3D printing, cyber security, autonomous robots and simulation. Okay, so daripada 4.0 ni teknologi yang ada, kalau kita apply ataupun kita map kepada medical healthcare punya environment, so kita boleh gunakan 3D printing ni untuk apa, untuk doktor lah kan, boleh gunakan untuk scan. Okay, kita boleh scan patient, so kita boleh lebih real lah dia punya image banding dengan 2D. Okay, so jadi doktor pun boleh analyse the image dengan lebih tepat lah Yeah. Then robotik, so kita pun dah ada robot yang boleh perform surgery. Okay, kita ada holography, hologram. So this one dia macam 3D juga. Okay, tapi kalau 3D tu dia kalau image digital kita tak boleh pegang lah. Tapi kalau kita print 3D punya model, kita boleh touch. Okay, so hologram ni dia 3D. Okay, tapi dia digital kan, kita tak boleh nak touch dia non contact 3D image. Kemudian sensor, so ada lots of sensor yang available. Kalau dekat hospital kita pergi tu kan, kita tengok patient tu banyak sangat sensor daripada body, ya. So different sensor, different objective, ya. Kemudian Internet of Things, so daripada sensor tadi, so kalau dia boleh communicate dengan server, dengan sensor yang lain, dengan device yang lain, so yang itulah adalah Internet of Things lah, connected, right? So memerlukan of course internet, Wi-Fi, okay? So big data, AI, so bila kita ada data yang banyak, okay, so kita perlukan AI lah untuk proses complexity of the data, right? Untuk mendapatkan output yang lebih tepat. Okay, ini contoh-contoh yang saya ambil daripada Google, ya. So kalau kita tengok daripada teknologi yang ada tadi, robot, 3D scan, so kita boleh gunakan dalam yang tu doktor gigi tu, dentist, okay, so yang tu dekat operation lebih precise, lebih tepat. Yeah,
precise.
So, kalau kita nak buat implant gigi dan sebagainya pun menggunakan robot ni lebih tepat. Okay. So sensors, ni sensors yang biasa adalah dalam medical untuk body temperature, EMG, ECG, right? Dan lain-lain lah. Eh? So IoT, so device, kemudian kita ada storage, so dia akan communicate menggunakan internet, okay? So dia ada proses juga lah di situ, apa ni, untuk collect data, pre-process dan sebagainya, sebelum kita simpan kepada storage untuk further analysis. Eh? Okay, this one 3D model medical imaging, so memang sangat baiklah compared to 2D image, right? So ini dia boleh 360, eh, doktor boleh move depan, belakang, atas, bawah, kan? Tengok walaupun patient berada di far, di tempat lain, kan, tak semestinya depan doktor, tapi ada di tempat yang berbeza, so doktor still boleh assist ataupun boleh apa ni, diagnose patient tersebut lah. Okay, so ni peralatan-peralatan di hospital. Okay, so dia tools dia advanced lah, dengan device-device yang ada. So in term of system, so semua tu kita boleh integrate. So at the end kita akan dapat satu solution, complete solution untuk digital hospital. So dekat situ kita ada sistem maklumat kita sendiri, okay. Kemudian ada device tadi connected, apa ni, sistem electronic health record tu sistem maklumat lah, kan, kita dah digital, kan, so all information kita ada dalam sistem. And then kalau kita pergi hospital, so automatically kita letak sensor dan sebagainya, dia dah boleh kenal lah siapa patient, dia boleh extract historical data kita yang sebelum macam mana. So sekiranya hospital tu juga connected dengan hospital lain, so mungkin apa ni, data atau maklumat daripada hospital lain pun boleh diakses lah oleh doktor. So this one hologram tadi, holography. So dia sebenarnya virtual jugalah, kan, tapi dia 3D punya. Right? So this one virtual reality. So kita boleh gunakan untuk inilah doktor boleh membantu dia lah untuk buat operation, kan. So virtual reality kadang di setengah tu dia pakai goggle, kan. So AI, robotik, so ada banyak algoritma yang dah ada sekarang ni, okay. Dan robotik, so sebenarnya dalam robot tu kita include teknik AI, teknik ke dalam robot tu lah, eh. So untuk apa ni, bagi robot tu berfungsi lah, kan. Okay, kemudian big data, so ada banyak sangat application berkaitan big data ni related to medical. bila kita ada big data untuk kita nak proses, kita perlukan machine learning lah, algorithm untuk buat analytics, untuk prediction dan sebagainya. So kalau tengok contoh kat sini, kita boleh buat preventing and epidemics, okay? Itu yang berlaku sekarang. So kita COVID-19. So dengan data-data yang banyak, kita boleh gunakan data untuk analyze so that kita boleh prevent epidemic. So yang tu juga nanti saya akan tunjukkan selepas inilah, berkaitan dengan one of the innovation yang kita telah buatlah di UNIZA. So kita boleh DNA and disease risk, okay? Ataupun kalau kita biasa dengan data-data DNA ni, lebih kepada bioinformatics. Okay, so kalau dia buat research bioinformatics, so dia memang big data punya research lah. Kemudian berkaitan dengan drugs, kalau kita ada drugs, kita boleh tengok effect, side effect drugs. Okay, fraud analysis. So macam mana kita katakan fraud analysis ke dalam healthcare ni? Katakan claim apa ni, insurans dan sebagainya. So mungkin ada yang data dia modify ke. So dekat situ kita boleh gunakan algoritma untuk detect fraud kalau dia nak claim insurans. Okay. Kemudian kita boleh gunakan data-data ni untuk decision yang lebih baik lah. Doktor boleh buat decision lebih baik. Sebab kita ada huge number of data, kita boleh analyse untuk the best outcome, okay? The best result untuk doktor buat decision. Okay, so saya akan pergi kepada case study. Di UNIZA kita ada satu sistem, nama dia CHASE. So this one related to analytic. So kita ada machine learning dalam ni. So nama sistem ni adalah COVID-19 health risk. COVID-19 health risk assessment and self evaluation system, CHASE. So yang ni kita start lagi last year, pada bulan Mac kita develop around 2 to 4 weeks, okay, pada masa mula-mula Malaysia kena lockdown pada Mac tahun lepas, okay. So at that time kita ada di UNIZA, kita ada faculty of medical, okay, for the faculty perubatan, okay, medical faculty. So kita team up dengan beberapa faculty jugalah. So kita hasilkan satu sistem untuk screening CHASE, okay. Pada masa itu belum ada lagi sistem, in fact di Malaysia pun belum ada at that time. So kita buat, tujuannya untuk untuk menilai risk COVID lah di dalam kampus pada masa tu, okay. Dan bila kita develop kita punya sistem sendiri, so kita boleh buat analisa, kita boleh dapatkan data lebih mudah lah, sebab data tu kita kepunyaan kita, it's our own data yang kita simpan dalam our own server lah. So at that time, so bila kita start tu, dilancarkan tu, kita dapat funding juga lah daripada beberapa ministry yang bagi funding. Okay, so kalau, so semua dah tahu pasal COVID-19, right? So ini dia lebih kepada, saya nak tunjuk meteorologi. Okay, so macam mana yang kita buat? So pada early stage tu kita buat literature. So pada masa tersebut memang data tak ada. Data kalau kat sini kita ada Kementerian Kesihatan Ministry of Health. Okay. So kes-kes COVID semua memang dekat hospital, tapi data dia orang tak share lah. Dia tak share data pada kita. So it's hard for the doctors untuk dapatkan real data from real patient yang COVID. Pada masa itu kita tak tahu simptom kan. Pada awal-awal tu simptom sangat banyak, tapi kita tak tahu yang mana satu simptom yang contribute ataupun yang relevant yang menyebabkan COVID. Okay, pada masa itu juga belum ada saliva test, kan? So ada kena swab. So swab tu pun susah nak dapat di hospital saja. So jadi for early stage penting untuk kita screen dulu lah. So untuk screen kita perlukan parameters. So pada masa tu belum ada lagi. Ada papers ada. So doktor-doktor kita, specialist doktor kita semua find papers, journal dan sebagainya untuk study apakah relevant punya simptom berkaitan dengan COVID. So dia listkan ada banyak, berpuluh saya rasa. Okay. And then dia case down kepada beberapa yang paling relevant lah. So yang penting untuk kita buat prediction ni adalah data. Okay. So dia perlukan knowledge, okay, historical data yang baik supaya outcome yang kita hasilkan juga tepat, hampir tepat. So selain daripada literature, daripada journal, so kita juga develop satu sub-module untuk kita dapatkan information daripada doktor-doktor lain. So kita blast macam questionnaire. So simptom batuk, let's say, so doktor-doktor di luar sana, di field, di hospital, dia akan jawab lah. So sama ada contribute berapa persen untuk batuk, dan juga untuk simptom-simptom lain macam mana. So data yang dapat tu kita analyse. So di akhirnya kita boleh buat satu model. So kita dah buat satu model. So model tu ketepatan dia hampir 99%. Okay, based on kita punya data yang ada lah, menggunakan regression model. So daripada model yang ada tu, kita map dalam kita punya sistem so that bila any user jawab, so dia akan produce output dalam tiga kategori. Saya boleh tunjuk kejap lagi. Sama ada high risk, low, medium risk ataupun low risk. Okay. So itu dia lead to, at the end, lead kepada analytics lah, kan? So kita boleh tahu berapa yang positif, berapa yang high risk, low risk. Okay. So proses ini berlaku secara paralel 2 to 4 minggu tadi, 2 to 4 weeks development. So apa yang kita buat, ada beberapa team yang work parallel. Okay. So ada yang buat knowledge, ada yang buat modeling, ada yang development. Okay. So at the end kita dapatlah satu apa ni, sistem yang digunakan sehingga hari inilah. Okay, ini antara teknologi yang kita guna. So machine learning, kita gunakan predictive dan juga classification. Kita ada gunakan Excel step di dalam Excel. Kita guna Laravel. And then for the modeling, kita guna juga Weka. Dan analytic, kita gunakan Power BI. Okay. So ni antara screen lah yang ada. Dua language, ada Malay and BM. Okay. So kita boleh gunakan any device. Boleh komputer, laptop, phone. So setiap so kita ada pelajar dengan staff akan log in. So nanti dia akan beritahu lah risiko kita sederhana atau sebagainya. So yang ni banyak membantu management. So untuk nak manage lah keadaan in the university. So nanti kalau kita tahu ada berlaku ramai yang high risk, let's say, so nanti universiti akan buat, akan ambil measurement yang sebaiknya lah berdasarkan data-data ini. Okay, so kita ada juga analytic graph, okay, berapa persen dashboard. Okay, and then this reference yang saya dalam slide ini lah, so saya dapatkan daripada beberapa sumber. So that's the source. So mungkin saya tunjuk how the system look like. Pak, nampak ke?
Not yet, Rob.
Not yet. Okay.
Okay. Okay. We can see it.
Okay, let's say we log in. Okay, so every day sebenarnya kita kena isilah, student atau staff akan isi.
Okay.
Ada two parts ni, soalan yang atas dan juga simptom kat bawah ni. Submit. And then we submit, so kita akan so kita dapat result. Dia ada tiga, medium, low atau high.
Alright.
Okay. Ada juga meter kat sini. So to come out dengan meter ni, kita perlukan regression model lah.
Alright.
Okay, so 100% kita boleh tahu how many percent untuk maximum high risk adalah 100%. So
100.
Untuk buat ni kita perlukan regression. So yang lain-lain ni adalah classification lah. So kita classify sama ada dia low, medium ataupun high risk.
Oh.
Okay, so doctors dia akan analyse lah data ni hari-hari.
No.
Staff and the student. So ada report. So dia boleh tengoklah berapa persen high risk tu disebabkan apa. So detail report ada untuk modul admin. Doktor adalah admin lah untuk this system. So, okay. Walaupun Malaysia ada daripada Ministry of Health tu ada, tapi the problem is data belong to them.
Okay. So, okay.
Kita tak boleh nak track dia punya data lah. So that we use and develop our own. So that every day kita boleh monitor health di kalangan staff and students university. So I think that's end our my presentation. Thank you.
Okay. Siap. All right. You are welcome. Okay. Thank you, Professor, for your excellent and interesting talk. So we will going ahead for a question and answer session. So it looks like we have already a few questions here. So okay, you still have time, Rob?
Yeah.
For the answer. All right, good. Okay, let me read it first. Okay, first question is coming from Abdul. Yeah. Okay, Abdul. As about, do you use the free train data for the system? How do you create free training data? Okay.
Sorry again, I don't get it.
Okay.
What data?
Train data. Trained.
Train.
Yes.
Training.
Yeah, train it. You can see on the chat box. You can see here.
Okay.
Abdul is
train data. Okay.
Okay.
Use pre-trained data in the system. Yes. Thank you. It's a very good question. So of course, bila kita nak produce a model, we need knowledge. So knowledge mean historical data.
Okay.
So yes. The data we get from the expert and also from the literature. And then the data we divide into training set and juga test set. So kita dapat daripada expert itulah kita gunakan train data. Okay, kita ada berapa ribu lah data from expert. And then data tu kita gunakan untuk training so that kita dapat model lah. At the end kita dapat model.
Alright.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, thank you, Rob. Okay, for the next question from Tania Gita. Okay, could you describe which part that Bidakta used in the implementation of the technology 4.0 in medical field?
Okay, thank you. Which part? At the end, kita start dengan data. Okay. Yes. So big data dia ada data tu yang pertama huge, kan? Yeah? Ataupun oh, yes. Ciri yang lain data tersebut from different source. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's say data tu from different source, kita ada image, and then data kita ada digital. Okay, so kalau data kita digital pula, dia divided into structured data, semi-structured data, unstructured. So those varieties of data, walaupun dia tak besar, dia kecil, tetapi oleh kerana dia different source variety, also kita namakan dia big data lah, ciri-ciri big data. So daripada situ sebenarnya memang di hospital data dia memang different source, kan? Ada daripada sensor, sensor sebenarnya data daripada sensor dia juga adalah big data sebab dia transmit data tu every second, eh? So that's big data punya features juga. So which part tu di dalam medical memang banyak lah, eh? Kalau image tu, image yang banyak besar, that's also big data. So kita nak X-ray, contoh X-ray, kan?
Yes.
Jadi kita X-ray, kita ada banyak image.
Image. Yes.
So dia memang sangat complicated juga lah, eh? So image processing pun dia apa ni, research yang menarik juga. Okay. Potensi dia pun besar, image processing untuk automatic kita nak apa ni, analyze image tu, eh, to X-ray punya image. Ada banyak pula image tu, kan? Dia sama ada apa ni, lung ke, kan, ataupun brain, eyes, so different part, different apa ni, application jugalah, kan? Sebab doktor pun dia ada pakar-pakar yang berbeza, eh, ada doktor okay. mata, doktor jantung lain.
Yes.
So selain daripada itu, sensor tadilah, eh, kita boleh gunakan kita boleh apa ni, big data boleh gunakan apa ni, berkaitan dengan sensor tersebut.
Alright. Okay, okay. Thank you. For the next is from the Rizka. Okay, Rizka asks about what exactly characteristic that can differentiate between Internet of Things and machine learning probe.
Okay, what exactly characteristic that can differentiate between IoT and machine learning? Okay, machine learning more to software, right? Software.
Yes.
Algorithm. Okay.
Yes.
Techniques, programming. Okay. IoT, walaupun dia ada a bit programming, tapi dia lebih kepada electronics.
Okay.
IoT, kan? So you ada sensor, you ada apa ni, Arduino. Okay, so semua tu adalah electronics punya part. Okay, so kita boleh dia ada dua bahagian lah untuk IoT. Yang pertama tadi electronic punya part, you kena develop prototype menggunakan Arduino, sensors dan sebagainya. And then dia ada a bit programming, eh, untuk programkan sensor tu, eh, nak save data dan sebagainya. Tapi kalau machine learning, dia tak involve electronic device lah, eh. Dia tak ada electronic. So kita just get secondary data. So data-data yang available, okay, secondary pun okay. And then kita process, and then kita nak dapatkan output. Machine learning ni maksudnya kita programkan komputer lah. Computer is machine. So macam mana kita nak train komputer untuk learn something? So kita kena buat program lah, eh? Kita code. So teknik sangat banyak lah, macam-macam algoritma ada. So kita boleh apply the best yang boleh suit kita punya problem. Kita boleh modify dan sebagainya lah. program lah, lebih kepada programming, machine learning. Okay. So begitulah kalau kita nak tengok karakteristik tadi, machine learning lebih kepada software, IoT lebih kepada physical, electronic, tapi ada part programming sikit.
Alright. Okay, thank you. Okay, for the next, Sri, you want to speak or say something? Or you want to say directly to the professor? Or maybe Puji? Okay, you have a question? Okay, let me see. Okay, just wait for that. Okay, next from the Sri. Okay, Sri. Okay, I'm interested in building a robot with an Internet of Things control system. Can you provide information related to the an interesting topic for your final project? Okay, in the robotics. And then she asked about, can building a robot for monitoring heart rate in real time be used as a final project? I will plan to make this. Okay.
Sri, well done. It's a very good project. Yeah. Okay. But unfortunately, saya pun tak not expert in robotic. Okay. Tetapi boleh explore. It's good, yes. Project. IoT, can building robot monitoring project. That depend kepada you punya requirement, university punya requirement kan. Dia mesti ada minimum requirement untuk final project. So that one, okay, depend on university. IoT nak link dengan nak control tu boleh. Kita boleh control apa ni, robot dengan IoT boleh. Okay.
Alright. Okay. Yeah. You can continue your plan, okay? Okay. And then next is coming from Puji. Okay. Assalamualaikum, Prof. Permission to ask, what language program do you use to make an application?
Okay. Yeah, this one. Okay. So we using open source punya teknologi, database, server, everything. So untuk processing ni, front end, back end, kita gunakan PHP. PHP, Laravel. This one developed using Laravel framework, PHP based.
Okay, Rizka, do you want to speak? Okay, please, admin, give to Rizka to unmute.
Rizka
want to speak to the professor directly. Okay, Rizka.
Hello, can you hear
okay
me?
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yes, yes.
Thank you. Before I'm giving you a question, I'm going to introduce myself that I was Rizka Bapa Pradana, and I was one of the student of University of Muhammadiyah Tasikmalaya. So right now I'm going to give you some questions, sir. So the question is that you say that the technologies of Industry 4.0 for the medical is that we get additive manufacturing, robotic, holography, sensor, IoT, big data, and AI. So the question is that what if there is no internet or IoT? Is the medical treatment can be worked as usual or not? That was the question. Right. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Yeah, it's a very hard question.
Okay.
it depend how you design the system. Okay. So let's say you focus that problem is to happen. So kita boleh design in case of ada problem internet. So maybe kita boleh design local ke kan? Mungkin ada dipanggil apa? Mungkin dia ada localized punya server kan, tapi kita still, betul lah internet tu penting, tapi katakan yes, tak ada internet tu, kita boleh design mungkin certain process kita boleh buat local, local area network. Okay, so bila internet okay, kita boleh connect balik kepada main server contohlah. Tapi to answer your question, yes, of course kita perlu internet lah, sebab kita share resources, kita share data. So kalau tak ada internet, kita tak dapat access data tu. Tapi fungsi hospital boleh berjalan sebab doktor ada. Kalau doktor ada, doktor pun specialist, dia boleh diagnose ataupun dia boleh buat treatment lah without have apa ni, data-data yang previous data. Okay, tapi mungkin decision dia pun limited lah, sebab kalau tak ada previous punya data kan. Pentinglah internet, penting. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Okay, how was it, Rizka? You got the point?
I'm mute.
Okay, and what first?
For the answer is, yeah, I get it. And the answer is, you can, yeah, the medical treatment can be work as usual. It depends what you working, what you do, right, sir?
Correct.
Oh yeah, thank you, sir.
All right, great.
Okay, thank you, Rizka. Okay, for your question. Okay, for next is Ferdi. Ferdi, you want to speak? You want to say something? You already send your question here.
Assalamualaikum.
Okay, waalaikumsalam.
My English is bad.
Okay.
No problem.
You boleh cakap.
Type in chat. I'm sorry, yeah, sir.
Yes. Yeah, no problem. You can communicate in Malay or Indonesia. I can speak a bit. Saya boleh.
Okay.
Indonesia certificate.
Yes.
Silakan.
Seperti yang kita tahu ya, teknologi blockchain sudah ada dalam beberapa tahap penggunaan seperti di masa industri 4.0 sekarang.
Yeah.
Seperti digital currency atau lebih banyak digunakan dalam bisnis cryptocurrency. Dan dalam sebuah teknologi kan pasti ada kelebihan dan juga kekurangan.
Betul.
Kalau menurut Bapak, apakah ada kekurangan dalam kelemahan kekurangan atau kelemahan dalam teknologi blockchain dan dalam real world usage-nya atau penggunaan dalam dunia nyata, apakah sepenting itu sebuah teknologi blockchain?
Okay, terima kasih.
Okay.
So kelemahan teknologi blockchain, it's hard to find it. Macam tak ada lah, sebab tapi kita perlukan kepada hardware yang powerful lah untuk proses data tu. Sebab tetapi blockchain dia memang safe. Sebab susah nak hack, kemudian dia tak boleh nak hack lah, data dia selamat. Selamat, that's why dia sehinggakan digunakan dalam cryptocurrency. Okay, so kelemahan dia, yang pertama mungkin sebab mahal lah, mahal kan. So nak set up teknologi ni sangat mahal sekarang. Okay, sehinggakan apa ni, kan dia ada miner kan, mesin. Kalau kita buat miner mesin tu, kita boleh dapat apa ni, dia boleh bagi dalam bentuk Bitcoin kan, kalau kita gunakan mesin kita untuk mine. Sebab mahal lah sekarang ni untuk proses apa ni, untuk membantu blockchain punya processing. Tapi in term of security, memang sangat secure. Okay, sangat secure. Kita di Uniza, kita gunakan blockchain. Kita have our own private blockchain. Kita ada blockchain yang private, maksudnya kita boleh gunakan di peringkat Uniza untuk scroll. Maklumat scroll dan juga transkrip kita simpan dalam Uniza punya blockchain network. So data-data tu selamatlah. Sebab kalau kita gunakan server biasa, kalau ada walaupun kita ada security password dan sebagainya, tapi kalau ada orang boleh hack server, dia boleh hack juga data tersebut. Okay. Tapi blockchain memang dia immutable, tak boleh nak hack lah. Okay, sebab dia replicate banyak tempat, dia ada banyak node, so dia memang tak boleh nak hack. It's very hard to hack. So, sebab cryptocurrency yang gunakan blockchain sekarang.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Ferdi. Okay, gimana? You got it?
Yes.
Semua memang bidang komputer ke? Ni sekarang?
Yeah.
Macam-macam komputer semua? Oh, okay.
Jadi kalau poin yang saya dapat, seperti keamanannya tinggi namun dibayar dengan harga yang mahal gitu ya. Okay, makasih, sir. Thank you.
Sama.
Okay. Anyone else want to ask to our professor here? Okay. You can speak directly, okay? Or raise your hand. Okay, Puji. You wanna say something, Puji? Okay, admin, please help Puji. Maybe you wanna say something. Puji, are you there? Okay, maybe trouble with the signal. Okay, maybe others. All right. Maybe there is no question.
Okay.
Professor, you want to say something before we close?
Terima kasih sekali lagi kepada Tas.
Okay. Yes.
Atas jemputan. Saya sangat hargai. Terima kasih banyak. So maybe we can work further collaboration, yes, in sure, research or whatever in future. Sure. Terima kasih sekali lagi.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, well, ladies and gentlemen, I think time is over for this session. I do apologize for a special question cannot be answered maybe directly, but you can still connect with the Professor Muhairi through an email, okay? We can take conclusion that the technology is really important for to help our activity. And then also technology development have the guaranteed numerous innovation opportunities such as a process improvement and technology implementation, such as for the patient experience, population health, and cost control and clinical satisfaction. Thank you again to our professor here, Rob Mohairi, for today's presentation and your contribution. I hope we can invite you again in the next programs, okay?
Inshallah.
Alhamdulillah. Okay, thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay, I will turn back to the... Okay, Miss Fitri, thank you.
Yes, well, ladies...